happy 4th of July weekend. It's coming Tuesday. Blessings to you. Have you got big plans? How many of you have big plans this weekend somehow? Wow, exciting bunch here this morning. Well, that's great. Since you don't have any plans, you can come on the 4th of July. Woo-hoo. There you go. Thank you. Sure. This morning, I want to talk to you a little bit about a guy by the name of Albert H. Wiggin. Albert H. Wiggin was born in the 1800s. He was born to a good family. His father was a Unitarian minister. They were kind of well-to-do. He grew up and had one brother named Langley and had a pretty good childhood. He grew and became involved in economics and banking, went to Boston English School and graduated there. He quickly began to rise in the banking world, got married to a lady by the name of Jessie D. Hayden, and by 1894, he was the assistant cashier of the Third National Bank of Boston. And he left there in 1899 to become vice president of the prestigious National Park Bank in New York. His star was on the rise. His rise continued. In 1904, this quiet reserved man became the youngest ever vice president of Chase National Bank. And in 1911, he succeeded Henry W. Cannon as president. By 1918, Wiggin had made Chase the fourth largest bank in the United States. Quite the pedigree. He rose to power, he rose to prominence, came into his own right in the middle of a boom. You might have heard of it called the Roaring Twenties. And he began to, anybody hear from the Roaring Twenties? It seemed that he was kind of in a prominent place right as the whole country, the nation, geared up as they began to, the economic boom was gigantic. It seemed that there was no end in sight. It seemed like nothing was impossible. It was out of this kind of economic plateau that the Great Gatsby was written in that era. It's a huge moment in the history of this nation in which fortunes were on the rise. So it came as a shock to a lot of people in 1929 as things began to dip a little bit. But they weren't worried because this had happened before. This had happened a couple of years previous. They were able to come out of it. It was just a market correction. No big deal. But right up until October 29th of 1929, everything was on the rise. Panic selling began on October 21st and reached its zenith on October 24th, on the 28th, and then especially on the 29th, October 29th, 1929, known as Black Tuesday, when the entire market crashed. It was preceded by the London market. The London Exchange began to a rapid sell-off, and so selling began to take place so fast that the economy couldn't keep up with it. There was so much debt. There was far more loans out than there was currency generated in the nation. Because they didn't see what was coming. They didn't see what was happening. Panic selling began. We've seen the pictures of people walking in soup lines, people unable to find, people in the Great Depression, which came as a result, or sometimes different, depending on who you talk to, different economists believe that it would have happened anyway, but certainly the crash did not help the Depression. And so for 12 years, the nation struggled, limped along, was finding difficulty making ends meet. There was no social net, safety net. There was no food stamp program. There was nothing to support, and so families were doing everything that they could just to survive. It became became a self-fulfilling prophecy. People were worried that banks would fail, so they pulled all their money out of the banks, causing the banks to fail. My grandparents grew up during this time. My grandfather talked about his brothers when he was very young, hopping trains as they came by to go to another county to catch work in an orchard or in a field just so they could eat for that day. Unbelievable time. And they didn't see it coming. Listen to some of the things that they said. We will not have any more crashes in our time, said John Maynard Keynes in 1927. You might have heard of Keynes. He was a very famous economist. There will be no interruption of our permanent prosperity, Byron Forbes said, the president of Pierce Arrow Motor Car Company in 1928. There is no cause to worry. The high tide of prosperity will continue, Andrew W. Mellon, Secretary of the Treasury in September of 1929. There may be a recession in stock prices, but not anything in the nature of a crash, Irving Fisher, leading U.S. economist, said in the New York Times in September, also 1929. No one saw it coming. No one could believe that it was possible. No one thought that that day would come. It was just going to continue to go up and continue to go up, that the economy was going to continue to get better. The Dow, this is kind of funny for us now, but the Dow was roaring. It was at 691. And people thought that it was going to stay that way forever. When the crash came in 1929, Wiggin joined with a group of other investors to stem the decline by purchasing large blocks of shares in major U.S. corporations at prices above the current market. And it worked for a short time. It stemmed the fall, but it didn't work for long. There was just too much to stop this huge wave, this huge bubble, we might call it now. It didn't work for long. This is what Wiggin said. We are reaping the natural fruit of the orgy of speculation in which millions of people had indulged. It was inevitable because of the tremendous increase in the number of stockholders in recent years that the number of sellers would be greater than ever when the boom ended and selling took the place of buying. He said, it's really sowing and reaping. And now we're doing a lot of the reaping when we thought we were doing most of the sowing. It had come and it arrived at long last. It had shown up. And although people saw the signs, they saw little glimpses of it, they were privy to some information maybe, they couldn't make themselves believe that it was ever possible in any way. And so the single greatest economic downturn in Western civilization happened and sent our nation spiraling into chaos. Now, why do I tell you about that? Why do I mention Andrew Wiggin? Why do I mention all of these different things? Because it is so similar to the context of Jeremiah's day. It is eerily similar. Oh, it's not necessarily just about economy. It's not necessarily just about financial markets or those things. But it was about the state of a nation. Israel and Judah had separated many years earlier, and they were two separate kingdoms. Israel in the north, with its capital in Samaria, and Judah in the south with its capital in Jerusalem. And even at the initial splitting up, there was already signs of trouble. Because in the north, the king in the north did not want, Jeroboam did not want people going south to worship in Jerusalem because he was worried they wouldn't come back. And people were resources. You needed them to work in agriculture. You needed them as merchants. You needed them to be where you were at. And so he was worried that if they continued to go south, they continued to go, I'm sorry, it's Rehoboam, not Jeroboam. If they continued to move south and go to Jerusalem, they would never come back. that's a big hit. And so he had a great idea, a very ungodly idea, but a great idea. And that was, we need them here politically to shore up my power base. We need them here economically. And so we're going to make our own high place like they have in Jerusalem. We're going to make an area, we're going to make an altar, a place up in the north in Dan where people can sacrifice, where people can do all those things that the Lord requires. And we're going to overlook the fact that the Lord said not to do that anywhere else in Jerusalem. And we're just going to go ahead and do that up here. So right at the beginning, you have the northern kingdom is founding itself on idolatry. And so they began to set that up. And so the nation began to have problems. And because of this, the nation began to a downward spiral, the northern kingdom. And we know that the Assyrians came and conquered them and carried them away. All the while in the south, the self-righteous and pretentious people of the southern kingdom of Judah said, "Oh, can you believe that happened to them? Can you believe how corrupt they became? Can you believe how they turned away from God? Man, thank goodness we have the temple. Thank goodness we're here." And so they in the south became very much like the Pharisee in Jesus' parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. Remember the one who goes into the temple, both men go into the temple, and the Pharisee begins to pray. Jesus said, "Oh Lord, I thank you that I'm not like other people, that I give more than them, that I'm better than them, that you made me in this state, that you gave me all this. Oh Lord, I thank you how awesome I am." And then it says the tax collector wouldn't even raise his head to heaven, but he just beat his chest, saying, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." Judah had become the Pharisee. Judah had become like them, thinking that they were God's favored people in the south because of Jerusalem, because of the temple. And so they too began a downward spiral, slower, but still downward, until we find in Jeremiah 33 where the enemy was encamped around the city, where the Babylonians were at the gate. And let me tell you about the Babylonians. They were one of the most brutal kingdoms, empires in the eastern world. The Assyrians were different than them. They were brutal as well. But they would come to a city and they would offer you an option. You can either become a vassal state of ours, or we can raise the city. And you can imagine many of those cities went, "Oh, look, come on in then. We don't want to do that." The Babylonians didn't do that. They believed that they were bringing order out of chaos. And so they raised everything. There was no option. So they're encamped about Jerusalem. And for years, Jeremiah had been proclaiming to the people to repent. To repent. There's still time. There's still time. Turn away. And much like the people in the 1920s, they covered their eyes and said, "No, no, no. This can never happen. It can never happen. Everything will be fine." And they didn't listen until at some point, Jeremiah told the nation, "It is now too late." This was before the Babylonians had ever arrived. "It is now too late. There can be no turning back. Even if you repent now, there is still judgment coming." Still. It was an unpopular message, as you can imagine. It got Jeremiah in a lot of trouble. The king, Zedekiah, did not like that message. And so he had Jeremiah arrested. At one point, he had him thrown down in a cistern where he had to wait until they wanted to take him out. He was miserable. At that point when he was in the cistern, he was really thinking about job change. He was really considering a new vocation. But he says something interesting. He says whenever he thought about that, about not preaching the word of God, what God was telling him to say, he said, "That word is like fire shut up in my bones. It has to come out." So they arrest him, and they hold him in the courtyard of the king, and he can't get away. And in Jeremiah 29, we see that he sends letters out. That's where we get that famous, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, that everyone..." It's always amusing to me sometimes. Forgive me, this is free, it didn't cost anything. It's always amusing to me sometimes when we use those scriptures and say, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord." In the midst of judgment, he says that. In the midst of the world falling apart, in the midst of all of those things, it wasn't necessarily a happy time. And yet, right in 29, we see that. Leading up to 33, when he's there again for a second time in the courtyard, and the Lord comes to him and gives him another word to share, which we just read. Now, why is that so powerful? What is so huge about that? Why is the context so important there? Because the world as they knew it was ending. It was ending. Imagine if the United States, or more specifically Texas, or more specifically Austin, well, maybe they can have Austin, but more specifically, the area that we're in is surrounded. That our walls are holding out for the moment, but there's a massive army, and word has come about what they've done to the other cities, and hope is rapidly fading out of the city, and people are doing despicable things to one another in a time of war. Horrible, horrible things happening. And it is apparent that they are going to get into the city. And so people began to make decisions about their families and their children that they would never consider, they would never make, if it weren't in the middle of a time of war. They knew that the Lord wasn't going to save them out of this one. That the Lord was not going to spare them from destruction. They had had that opportunity. They had tried. And so in their mind, even God had abandoned them. Do you get the picture? Hopeless. I've mentioned this before, but there's a movie that came out several years ago with Mel Gibson and Patrick Stewart and Julia Roberts in it called Conspiracy Theory. It's about a man who is a little different, we'll say, and goes around and he has all these conspiracy theories. The funny thing is, one of them turns out to be true. And it's a story about that. And they capture him because they had done all these tests on him. And Patrick Stewart is the bad guy. Sorry to ruin that for you. But Patrick Stewart's a bad guy, and he's messing with Mel Gibson. And he says this one phrase. He says, the character's name is Jerry that Mel Gibson plays. He says, "Have you ever been to a place, Jerry, from where there is no hope?" That is Jerusalem. There's no hope. It's completely lost. They know it's coming. It's upon them now. There's no turning back. And yet something very interesting happens in that. The Lord, through the prophet, tells them, as bad as it is, as wicked as you become, I will not abandon you. Oh, you're going to go through this. You're going to suffer the consequences, but I will not utterly destroy you from the face of the earth. In fact, when you go off into exile, I will go with you. I will be there. And just to let you know that all is not lost, I'm going to have Jeremiah buy a piece of land from his cousin as a down payment, a guarantee that once again there will be planting and harvesting. Once again, there will be working out in the vineyards because I'm going to restore the land. We see that in this prophecy. Listen to the rest of 33. This is what the Lord says. "You say about this place, it is a desolate waste without men or animals. Yet in the towns of Judah and the streets of Jerusalem that are deserted, inhabited by neither men nor animals, there will be heard once more the sounds of joy and gladness, the voices of bride and bridegroom, and the voices of those who bring thank offerings to the house of the Lord, saying, give thanks to the Lord Almighty, for the Lord is good, his love endures forever. For I will restore the fortunes of the land as they were before, says the Lord. Now that is going on as huge rocks are pounding against the walls of the city, as the sounds of war are breaking out everywhere you go, where people are running in panic. In the middle of that, the Lord says, it's not over completely. Once again, I'm going to bring back all these things. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In this place, desolate and without men or animals, in all its towns, there will be again be pastures for shepherds to rest their flocks. In the towns of the hill country, of the western foothills and of the Negev, in the territory of Benjamin, in the villages around Jerusalem, and in the towns of Judah, flocks will again pass under the hand of the one who counts them, says the Lord. In other words, all over this land, there will once again be people. There will once again be life and commerce and blessing. Everything that has happened before will happen again. I will not completely give up on you. It is the picture of a parent who comes down on their children hard, but in the end still loves them. I remember, this is kind of funny, and he's not here, so he won't mind me sharing it. I kind of remember when Michael was little, and he just wouldn't go to bed. One night I'd call my dad. I said, I don't know what to do. I've had to give him a spanking 5 times. He will not go to bed. To which my dad replied, is that right? He laughed at me. And Michael, when he would, we didn't even really have to give him a spanking, because he would work himself up into this frenzy that it was unbelievable to watch. It was comedic. And so we were trying really hard not to laugh and be serious when he's getting his spanking or about to, or you need to go to your room. And we'd warn him once, and we'd warn him twice, and then we'd send him into his room, and he would melt down. This little 6-7-year-old just melt down. He would just, and he'd just start shaking, and he'd be crying. We'd say, go to your room. We didn't even do anything. Just go to your room. Okay, you did it now. Go to your room now. And he would just melt down. And then we'd get in there and say, okay, you got to get your spanking. And he would freak out. And I was trying so hard not to laugh. Trying so hard. He just, how could this happen? And he would do the dance. Y'all know the dance, right? When you get ready to get the spanking, and you're doing this, right? The kids are running away from you, and they're doing all of that. And no matter how bad it got, and he would tell me this much later, no matter how bad, no matter how tough, he always knew that wasn't the end of it. He knew we loved him. He knew that that moment, that time period of correction and discipline, that time period getting the consequences of what he had done was not the end of it. It wasn't just to leave him there and he was now in disfavor forever with the family. It didn't work like that. No, he knew that that time is over now. And now you've been restored back into blessing. That's exactly what the Lord is telling them in this time. Now, albeit there are very different circumstances, but it's the same principle that God says, I'm not going to abandon you. I'm not going to give up on you. You're going to go away into captivity. In fact, he said through the prophet, when you arrive in Babylon, settle down. Marry and give in marriage. Get land, plant crops, plan to spend some time there. Support, now this was unheard of in the ancient world, support the government that has enslaved you. Because you're going to be there a while. But eventually, you will come back. What's interesting is, they came back in 1948. They came back to work the land who were not farmers, who had no agricultural experience, who had no idea what they were doing, and the land bloomed under their touch. A land that had laid desolate, that had, according to Scripture, according to the word of the prophet, had laid under many Sabbaths until that time that God's people came back in the land by His hand and the land came alive. It wouldn't bear fruit for anyone else until the time had come in 1948 and the land is coming to life. If you've never been, it is amazing to watch. It's amazing. You just drive down and you see there are over 7 million, 7 million, I might get this wrong. There are 7 or 8 million different varieties of birds that fly over the nation migrating. There are date palms that had been extinct since the time of Jeremiah, since the time of the Babylonian captivity, that they are reintroducing into the land. They put rocks in the ground and probably something would sprout out of it. It is unbelievable, but it is a fulfillment of what God said through the prophet Jeremiah. One day you will come back. Now, why do I tell you all this? What's the purpose of Andrew Wiggin? What's the purpose of the context of Jeremiah? What does this have to do with the church, DSUMC, and Dripping Springs? How does that affect us? It's to tell you this. There's always hope. Always. No matter how dark it gets, no matter how tough it seems, no matter what's going on, there is always hope. We have a God who will never abandon us in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We're not alone. Even in the midst of that, even in the midst of incredible suffering, God sends that word to Jeremiah. God sends that word of hope to Jeremiah. Now, unfortunately, Andrew Wiggin was not like Jeremiah. You see, it came to light many years later, although nothing had been done illegally, Andrew was shorting stocks in his own company and made $4 million in the midst of this stock fall. Wickedness. Wickedness. He saw it coming, and rather than warn, he made a profit. Just like all the leaders in Jerusalem. Oh, no, it's fine. Just like the king. Oh, no, it's fine. He wouldn't even believe when Jeremiah prophesied to him, this city will be taken, and you will be hauled off to Babylon, and you will sit eye to eye with Nebuchadnezzar. He wouldn't believe it. But even in the midst of that, there's hope. Remember Elijah running away from Carmel after he does this incredible miracle and God shows up in this incredible way, and then word gets back to Jezebel and she says, get word to Elijah, I'll be coming to see him soon. And so what does Elijah do? This incredible miracle worker, this guy who called down fire from heaven, he cries and he runs off in terror. Never understood that. And he starts to have the pity party down by the river. Oh God, it's the end. It's all over with. It's all over. I'm the only one left. I'm the only faithful one left. You know, the martyr. It says, God says, no, you're not. I have reserved 7,000. There are others.